wow. How could they bust Goody Two-Shoes Charlie for anything?
Look at the cannon. Wow, you can't even walk down the street without the man rousing you, man.
Ah, the cop's out of pound sand.
I wonder what kind of guy would want to be a cop anyway.
Bill Bryan.
Okay.
I think we can fix this for you, honey. Okay?
A police officer must be part priest, part psychiatrist, part social worker, part karate expert, and he must be able to make a decision in a few seconds that will stand up before complex legal scrutiny all the way up to the U.S. Supreme Court.
Dad, we're gonna be late.
Well, I'll tell you, old man, if you come over here and help me, we'll be through in half the time.
True enough, but there's more to be said. Take Bill Bryan, a family man like most of his fellow officers, and like all fathers, he's expected to be able to remedy any calamity, to fix just about anything. Certainly his daughter is convinced of that. Officer Bryan firmly believes that athletics is one of the best ways to teach and build discipline. That discipline which is so essential for young people to learn before they are faced with the responsibilities of adulthood. For that reason, Bill Bryan finds time from his own scant time off to act as a coach for his son's team. Officer Bryan and his partner Williams are part of a team. A team whose members must not only be well-trained soldiers, but also act as street corner sociologists. Someday the public in America will realize that the police officer has more to do with the state of our nation than any other man on the street today.
Unit 577, Williams and Bryan.
1A55, Roger.
The first call is not long in coming.
1A55, 488 suspect in custody at 10712 Washington Boulevard at the dress shop.
A girl, 16 years old, is accused of shoplifting. A polite word for stealing. The manager had seen her go into the dressing room with four swimsuits and come out with only two. She waited until the girl left the store and stopped her outside. The girl had returned the swimsuits as soon as she was accused and now thought she'd paid her debt. And, of course, her girlfriends were providing all the moral support.
Do you want to press charges against this young lady?
You bet your life I want to press charges. If I don't, she'll be back here again next week. If not this shop, one down the street.
I'm sorry, miss, but you're going to have to come down to the station with us.
You really want blood, don't you, lady? I gave you back your crummy swimsuits. You think I was a criminal or something. I have my rights. I want a lawyer. I'm a juvenile. You can't touch me.
The manager is right. You can't cure people of stealing by turning them loose. But once a shoplifter has been formally arrested, he seldom commits the crime again. This young lady may learn that stealing is the most expensive way of acquiring anything. It may mean a criminal record that can never be erased. Call follows call. Bryan and his partner Williams respond. A woman reports an attempted burglary. Returning from a shopping trip to the market, she surprised a man trying to get into her house in full daylight. And to prove her story to the officer, she shows him the fingerprints on the windowsill. This case will have to be handled by the detective division. A drunk driver who got into trouble going the wrong way on a one-way street is given the field sobriety test. The man is obviously intoxicated and very antagonistic. When it becomes necessary to subdue the suspect, Bryan is acutely aware of the spectators. He knows their all-too-frequent reaction. If he lets the suspect hit him, they'll call him a coward. If he has to hit the suspect, he's a brutal bully. This creek bed is one of the most dangerous areas in town for children to play, even in the daytime. The city has fenced the whole area off, but it just seems to add that much more challenge to the young adventurer. The officers know only too well the many possible dangers that may be waiting in the dark for a child alone. The boy says he was just taking a shortcut. Bryan decides he had better see the boy safely home. A young boy out at this time of night in an undesirable part of town is a prime target for the child molester. We read in the paper every day where innocent children, not given the proper guidance, have become victims of these sick minds. But parents continue to believe it always happens to the other guy. The boy's father wants to know what it's all about. And Bryan tells him that as a parent, he should always know where his son is and what he's doing. Perhaps Officer Bryan is overstepping his authority a bit, but the boy is so very much like his own. Wears on, and like every other night, Bill Bryan and his partner respond to call after call.
Good evening. What seems to be the problem here?
The young police officers are asked to solve many of society's ills. Domestic problems and quarrels account for a large portion of their calls. And many times they're called upon on the spot to settle the domestic differences of couples many years their senior. More often than not, the heat of the dispute is over by the time the officers arrive, and the offended marriage partner declines to press charges.
No, I don't think so.
And domestic peace and tranquility reign once again.
My husband has a friend on the city council, and I'm sure that we can do something about this. I want your name and I want your badge number, because I'm going to have you reported.
Bryan listens and Williams looks. Even though a lot of prowlers are heard but not seen, and are probably cats or just the wind blowing, they nevertheless thoroughly investigate every report.
Where have you been? I've been calling the police station. I called them 10 minutes ago. And I know I have prowlers around the house. I am a nervous wreck. My dogs have been barking. My lights are all on. I've been running around the neighborhood looking for someone. In the backyard, my gate is open. You're so busy giving parking tickets, but when it's an emergency, you never can be found.
Yes, ma'am, I understand.
It's his duty and desire to see that everyone in his community is given all possible protection. Williams reports everything is clear, and Bryan assures the woman they will drive by periodically and keep a close watch on her residence. Officer Bryan and his partner respond to a code 2 call, shots fired, and find themselves in the middle of a heated landlord-tenant dispute. The landlord accuses the tenant of firing several shots from a .38 that he knows the man owns.
A
to upset and annoy the other tenants.
Yeah, you can see it, but it won't do you any good. Sir, what makes you so sure the shots came from his apartment?
Well, I was standing right outside the door.
How many shots did you hear?
Three.
How many shots?
It seems just a petty squabble like so many others, but Bryan will investigate until he is certain of what happened. If shots were fired, it might be necessary for him to go through the entire building to see that everything is all right. Happily, this time, that won't be necessary.
You think they really came from his apartment?
Certainly, I'm sure. There's no doubt about it.
Firecrackers. Some prankster's idea of a practical joke. So they were both right. Firecrackers do sound like a .38. Bryan must be diplomat enough to settle a quarrel between individuals so that each will think he won. In response to an officer needs assistance call, a teenage party. The lone officer felt it was more than he could handle by himself. He suspected drugs. The officers cannot know what to expect. If the kids are on pills, they may resist arrest. If it's marijuana, they'll be incoherent and unpredictable. If it's speed, they can almost certainly expect a fight. It's amazing how these kids will demonstrate a little sleight of hand and never crack a smile. A treehouse. You'd think these kids were a little too old for that kind of thing. Bryan is thankful for a peaceful reaction. Seems such a waste. The way these kids will fill their lungs with the smoke of a weed and then rejoice because everything is distorted. This incident will leave its damaging imprint on the lives of these youngsters much more than they now realize. It happens often, much too often. But each time, Bryan is still hit by the senseless, thoughtless action. And his thoughts always go back to his own children. Suspicious to an officer on patrol and someone trying not to be seen. The girl is too well groomed and expensively dressed to be sitting in this old car. Bryan's training and experience warn him, and he decides to investigate further. The horn is obviously a signal. She's probably a lookout for a burglar inside. Williams will check the back of the house.
Help!
The people in the neighborhood, some of them already hostile towards the police, are convinced they are witnessing a case of flagrant police brutality. A catch-all phrase which can mean anything from a stern look to actual mistreatment. Knows it's vital that he keep his cool, but he feels beating down upon him the resentment, almost hatred, for the hunky cop of the people in their rebellion against any authority. Their whole community has been shortchanged by society, and in their confused bitterness, the people take it out on the police officers, who try to maintain an orderly society and give protection. The situation is explosive, and Bryan radios, "Officer needs help." Bryan would give anything to be able to reach the people and reason with them, achieve a true meeting of the minds. It will come to pass. The police department already has many programs designed to promote understanding and cooperation. But meanwhile, it's the job of Bryan and the other officers to try to prevent serious trouble. It's very late when Officer Bill Bryan finally gets off duty. It's been a long night, filled with the routine of police work. The next morning, Officer Bryan must go to court after working long into the night to testify in cases in which he was involved. For Bill Bryan, police work isn't just a 9-to-5 job. It's a profession.
Jefferson and Oberlin at the Union Station, a 211 just occurred. Shot fired. Suspect described as a male Caucasian, 17 to 18 years. Light blonde hair, wearing a blue shirt and blue jeans. Suspect left on foot, westbound on Jefferson Boulevard. Suspect has a blue steel 2-inch revolver.
Young people watching the incident are even now jumping to a conclusion, the wrong one. They see only part of the whole picture. And from what they see, they assume they know it all. It happens all the time. But as with a movie, watching just part of it isn't going to give the whole the true story. The boy can identify himself. He lives in the neighborhood and can account for his whereabouts and destination. And he can prove to the satisfaction of the officers that he cannot possibly be the suspect sought. Officer Bryan makes a point of telling the boy the reason that he was stopped, and he explains to him why he was searched. This, then, is Officer Bryan, Bill Bryan, a normal guy like most everyone else, doing a job the best he can, a job he believes in. The job of protecting his community and every citizen in it. Bill Bryan.